Chapter 43. I grabbed the jutting corner of the box and tugged. It didn't give. There was a thudding crunch as Salvador jumped down beside me. He didn't say anything. He just scooped away the dirt around the box with his fingers while I wiggled and pulled at the box. Sometimes I stopped pulling and worked with him, scraping the dirt away. But he never took hold of the box himself, never yanked on it or tried to jerk it free, even though there was a distant chance he was stronger than me. He never tried to pull it on himself. I think he knew that moment was for me. We got more and more of the corner showing, and then another corner, and we sped up, Salvador digging with both his hands like a dog and leaning back, pulling my legs into it, straining to bust that box loose. I was getting shaky, like when you're so super starving you can barely stand it. And then you see the plate coming, hot and salty. And then it broke free. It tilted and slid out into my hands. I was holding it. I was holding that box, and just like that, I remembered. Dirty, scratched up, and dented. But other than that, it was just like I remembered. And it was in my hands. It was warm. I don't even know why, but it was warm. I held that box in my hands, and I stopped breathing, and I took every breath in the world. My mom, my sisters, my mom, my sisters. I held that box, and I held them. I held that box, and every, the end, every once upon a time that ever rang out at the same time, all tangled up together. With a slow, careful hand, I wiped the dust off the top of the box. It was dinged up and dirt encrusted and rusty. It was perfect. I realized I was kneeling. I had no memory of dropping to my knees, but there I was on my knees in the dirt. I rose to my feet. I tried to breathe, tried to clear my eyes. I looked over at Salvador, who was looking back at me, his eyes deep in solemn pools. I nodded to him once. He nodded back once. He was still breathing hard from the chase, the digging, the finding. So was I think. I looked up out of the ditch, past the waiting machines and watching workers. There was one tree left in the park, one way over at the edge that hadn't been ripped out. Maybe it wasn't in the way and would be spared, or maybe they just hadn't gotten to it yet, but it was still there for that moment, still dropping shade like they all had on those days all that time ago, and on one day in particular. I stumbled out of the ditch, holding that box with two hands and one heart. I rose up out of the earth that was raw and torn up like a freshly dug grave. Salvador's footsteps scratched along behind me. There were a few guys standing with crossed arms. I guess they'd been watching the whole thing. They stepped to the side and let me pass. I made my way toward the tree that stood alone, all of its family ripped away. Salvador's footsteps stopped at the line of the workers, and he let me go on by myself. I heard one of the guys grumble, "What is it?" And I heard Salvador answer low, "It's a memory box. She buried it there with her mom." And then I heard someone say, "Well, where's her mom?" And Salvador almost whispered his answer, but I still heard it. "She's dead." And then there was a big silence and a heavy silence, an understanding kind of silence. And not one of those folks said a word, and one of those folks complained about the interruption, and not one of those folks told me to hurry the heck up so they could get back to work. "Hey," the voice cut through the moment. It was the cop, of course. "Hey, where are you going?" His voice got louder as he spoke, so I knew he was jogging up behind me. "Leave her alone, man," I heard one of the guys grumble. "Leave her alone? Do you have any idea what she..." "Oh, give it a rest, dude. You can wait 1 minute. I mean, she ain't going nowhere, right?" The cop, though, would not give it a rest, and he wasn't going to give me 1 minute either. "Stop," he said, and I could hear his angry footsteps stomping up behind me. "Can you hear me? Stop." I could, and I didn't. I was going to the shade of that tree, the last standing tree, and I was going to sit down in whatever shade she offered, and I was going to open up that box, and I was going to spend a little time with my mom and my sisters right here in our park. But the cop wasn't giving up that easy. He puffed up beside me. "Hey," he said gruffly, "you need to stop." I kept my eyes straight ahead and my feet moving. I didn't trust my throat to speak. The memories were all around me, the ghosts waiting under the tree. I didn't want to lose them ever again. "Hey," he said, and he grabbed my arm. "You need to stop now." His fingers locked onto my arm hard, and he stopped me hard and spun me around hard. He was all hardness, that cop. I didn't have it in me to deal with all his hardness because there was nothing hard left in me. I was soft and broken and fallen apart right down to my middle. But I was ready to fight that cop to the end to do what I needed to do, what I was aching to do, what I was almost dying to do. I was ready to fight his hardness because, gosh darn it, the world is hard enough as it is without hard people making it even harder. I was ready to fight. Turns out, I wasn't the only one. I'd only gotten as far as opening my mouth when there was a coming at us fast drumming in the ground, a little thunder rolling our way for just a second before it got to us. Well, before she got there. She hit him from the side and she brought a cloud of dust with her. Gladys came flying from our periphery, her head lowered and her horns ready, and she gave that cop a head button he ain't never gonna forget. Yeah. She rammed him hard. That hard cop met the hard end of a hard goat, and the goat won. There was a grunt and a coughing whoosh of breath when she hit him. He went straight down to the ground and skidded a bit on his butt, his feet sticking up in the air. When he came to a rest in the little dirt cloud, Gladys stood over him, head lowered, pawing in the ground with a hoof and clearly ready for round two. The cop looked up at her. And I'd say the vast majority of the hardness had left him. His eyes were as wide as quarters, his face pale, his mouth hanging open. "I'm sorry, officer," I said quiet. "She's a good goat, and a goat is a loyal animal." The cop just stared at me. I think he was fairly rattled, and I can't say that I blame him. "I'm going to go over there, that tree over there, and I'm going to go through this box just for a few minutes. And then I'll go with you. You don't need your gun. You don't need your handcuffs." I looked at Gladys, who was still trembling with ready indignation. "You probably do need to avoid eye contact and sudden movements, though." Gladys snorted. The cop twitched and flinched. "Just a few minutes," I repeated right into his eyes. "Okay?" The cop swallowed, eyes still wide. He nodded. "Thank you," I said, and the box felt heavy in my hands, and it felt weightless. I turned and walked over to the tree and knelt down in the grass. I set the box on the ground in front of me. There was a little metal clasp that clicked shut and held the box closed. Slowly, I lifted it up. It was rusty and it was stubborn, but after a second, it popped up and opened. I took a breath, one deep breath of air down into the very bottom of my lungs. I felt them. I felt them all around me, looking over my shoulders, putting their arms around me. They were there. I opened the box. Chapter 44. Here's a memory. I don't know when it was exactly. Not that long before we buried the box. Not that long before everything. It was spring, but the warm kind. The kind of spring that's already trying sometimes to be a summer. We went for a hike, all five of us, just up in the hills around Poplin Springs. It was something we did. We walked up the dirt trail, up out from the valley floor, up to the top of the hills where we could see the distant mountains and the bends of the river and the town laid out below us all miniature. It was steep and it was long, but we could see forever up there, it felt like. And a chance to see forever is worth the work. The slopes were green with spring's rain and sun, the grass long and bright, swaying like seaweed in the breeze. The fields were exploding with wildflowers and purple lupin and yellow balsam root and little white ones I'd never known the name of. So much color, so much living, so much life up there that sometimes your eyes didn't believe it. And sometimes you even had to whisper to your own heart, "No, it's real. It was heaven." Rodeo was there back before he was Rodeo, back when he was just Dad and I was just his daughter, one of his daughters, and Rose, her legs too little for the long climb, riding up on Rodeo's shoulders, and Ava, long-legged, long-haired, talking with her hands, and me, back when I was Ella, just Ella, the daughter, the little sister, the big sister, the one in the middle, never alone back then, and Mom, oh, Mom, Mom with the voice like warm honey, Mom with the touches that made everything better. I held my mom's hand as we walked, hers bigger than mine, soft, warm, and safe. Near the top, I dropped her hand and ran ahead of the family to beat them to the top. The sun was just getting to setting, dropping down below the mountains on the horizon. The light was coming in, long sideways beams through the clouds, slanting sharp and golden through the grasses, through the flower blooms, stretching up toward the sky. I stopped there in the middle of all the glory. I turned back to my family walking up toward me. Mom came first, walking by herself. Dad and Ava and Rose were farther back, taking their time, talking and meandering. But Mom came first, following my footsteps, wading off the trail and into the grass and flowers to come my way. She didn't come straight to me, though. Even though I wanted her to, she walked off to the side just a little, finding her own path. She stopped off by herself, facing into the sunset. Her eyes were alight with the sun's fire. Her hair blew in wisps around her face. The sunlight hit her face, and it was pure gold. She looked off into the distance, and I saw her take a breath, a deep breath, and let it out slow. And then she turned her head and looked at me, looking at her. There was nothing but green and bloom and light between us. And she smiled at me, a sharing smile, a smile that was just for me, a smile that said all the most beautiful things that mom says to daughters. And I smiled back, a smile that said all the most important things that daughters say to moms. You know what? I don't think I'm ever going to see anything in my life more beautiful than my own mama smiling in the sun. I got a whole life ahead of me, but I just don't believe that I'll ever see anything more beautiful than that and than her. I loved her so much in that moment I could barely breathe. It almost choked me how much I loved her. All I was in that moment, all was loving her. I loved her. I loved her. I loved her. That's it. That's the whole memory. The memory doesn't have any words. It doesn't need them.